In this unit, we'll learn about two methods of request and response in DNS servers. The first method is the iterative method. In this method, every server in the hierarchical tree refers the local server to a different server, which gets closer to the result. We'll demonstrate the method with the following example. Let's say a client in the domain cis.poly.edu wants to refer to the site gaia.cs.umass.edu. At the first stage, it refers to the local server, which is managed by the ISP. If the server has the address, it will be provided directly to the client, who can then refer to the website. If the local server doesn't have the required address, the local server will serve as a dedicated proxy for the client, meaning that it will search for the address in the hierarchical tree and will eventually provide it to the client. The local server refers to the root DNS, which returns a kind of "I don't know the required address" message, but sends the IP address of the TLD server below it, which might know the address because it fits the EDU field. The local server refers to the TLD server, which returns a response with the address of the authoritative server of cs.umass.edu. The local server refers to the authoritative server, which provides it with the website address. The local server saves the address in the cache while resetting the time to live and returns a response to the client. Usually the process happens on UDP protocol, but in some cases can also happen on TCP. The second method is the recursive method. In this method, every server actually takes upon itself the job of searching for the address. So the request chain is deep. If we look at the scenario from the previous slide, in this case, the local server will refer to the root server, which itself refers to the TLD server, which refers to the authoritative server. The response returns along the entire length of the chain. There are advantages and disadvantages to each method. In the recursive method, the address is learned along the entire search chain, whereas in the iterative method, the address is learned only on the local server. On the other hand, the recursive method may experience greater loads on already overloaded servers, like the root and TLD servers. As I noted in the previous slide, the DNS servers have a cache, which saves addresses from previous queries. This way, the search routes will at least partially not be needed. The response will be returned faster, and loads will decrease. Each listing in the cache has a time to live attached, which is a kind of a number, and when it expires, the listing is deleted. This way, local servers can skip over root servers straight to TLD. If a server changed its IP address, the information won't be updated globally until the time to live expires on all servers. In every request or response to a DNS query, there is a type which defines what it contains. Additionally, the server sending the response also defines its time to live. Examples for query types or response types can be type equals A, which is a listing of type IPv4, which belongs to a specific domain name. IPv4 is a 32-bit based IP address. AAAA, like the A type, this listing is based on IPv6, which is the up-to-date version of IP addresses, which we'll learn about later. Type NS, which is a listing representing a server which is in charge of providing information on the desired domain. PTR, which is a listing containing a domain which is allocated to a specific IP address so that the DNS server can search for domains by IP address. MX contains the address of the server that the domain uses for receiving email. There are many more types. In this unit, we learned extensively about types of DNS servers, their hierarchical tree, and the two methods for request and response of DNS queries.